I have been pondering over the last week. I've been thinking about it. The difference in life between the time when I was a child and the present time. Now, I don't mean from the point of view of my personal life or anything psychological or emotional. I mean from the social point of view. It's a very interesting change that has taken place. As I have spoken in the past, there was a very great change in society that took place when the phenomena of modernity started to manifest in the present social situation. Modernity means that there was a enormous shift in the way that people lived, in the facilities available to them, and in the way they viewed life. Since we've already talked about this, I will simply summarize this in a simple way. For thousands of years, people lived in a very simple manner. You could call it village life, you could call it agriculturally based, but there were cities, so that wouldn't really work. Basically, you could speak of it in terms of a society that ran on the labor of the human being and the animal. That would be a fairly good summary. The human beings were engaged in work, physical labor, using animals to plow the fields, to bring things, all transportation was man and animal, all work was man and animal. So there were these many activities, many occupations. Families were all engaged together to survive, to prosper, to make their lives better. It was a very close society. And people worked together because they had to, because their survival depended on it, because their entire existence depended on it, because everything they were, everything they wanted to be, depended on it. Something started happening when the steam engine appeared. Because when the steam engine appeared, and especially it was used in trains, the entire society changed. Suddenly, you could transport things long distances, and they would last. Sure, previously they had boats, but they couldn't transport anything that was fresh. Everything had to be packed in salt or pickled in barrels or dry. On a train, you could suddenly bring food, for instance, from many hours away. And this started the destruction of the local economy, where everything was localized and everything was interdependent locally. And even though it might have been a small step at that time, because there were not that many people importing things on the train, relatively speaking, the local economy was still quite strong. But it created a possibility. It created a potential. All of a sudden, machines became a viable alternative to the human being. Powered machines. Previously, they also had machines. But these machines were powered by people or by animals and people. Because even if there's an animal doing it, there's a people directing the animal. Now there's the possibility of having a machine that doesn't need an animal for power, but which instead takes some fuel and does things that hundreds and hundreds of horses couldn't do. So then the human mentality went towards how to expand this. And then instead of steam, the internal combustion engine was created. I don't know, sometime around the 1850s, I guess. 1858, I don't remember exactly, but somebody figured out how to make an engine that ran on some kind of petroleum-based product. And after that, the airplane appeared. And ships had engines in them that were no longer dependent on the wind. And weaponry expanded accordingly. No longer did you have to worry about some soldiers marching into your town, but now you had to worry about very long very long missiles coming, airplanes dropping things. So it is a problem. It is a serious problem that war became much more destructive. Rockets were developed. Okay, you get it. You understand it. I made my point. Now, I even see it. The difference between when I was a child and now. I see the difference in terms of when I was a child, things were quite simple. I mean, okay, TV had just kind of been invented and people were getting TVs, but TV was not, in one sense, so significantly different because you could go to the movies. Talking pictures were already commonplace. So a TV simply took the talking pictures from the movie and put them in your living room. Fantastic, sure. But not like mind-boggling, or it didn't really add another dimension to life, which As we think about it today, was so earth-shattering. It was kind of, okay, cool. We liked it, good. It was like instead of sitting around the radio and listening to the, you know, the shadow or whatever, you now watched on TV. Although there were only like three stations, and although the shows were not very good, but still you had something. But what was life mainly? Life was mainly you go out with your friends and you do things, you play. You do sports, you play games, you hang out, you wander around, you do things with groups of people. All the adults were doing the same thing. Everyone was sharing a communal environment. And this communal environment was very, shall we say, based on sharing. There was an interconnectivity. Okay, our economic basis was no longer dependent on the communal environment. But still, people did services for each other and were paid for it in the local area. There was work, there was things to do to maintain. It was a lot based in the human being doing some work somewhere. Now I look at my life today. Here I am, sitting in a room alone. The only company I have is my dog, who just became frustrated with this whole thing and walked away. I hear Maha in my ear. I don't see him. I know you're out there. And outside of somebody complaining to me on the messenger about something or other, about the broadcast, which I know, it's going to be tough for a while. I don't see you. I know you're there, at least some of you. I know you're there. But outside, I'm in a neighborhood where, yeah, you can say hi to people. You don't hang out. The kids don't hang out. For them to get somewhere, they have to be driven by their parents. They're absorbed in computer screens, iPads, iPods, iPhones, TVs, computer games. Everything happens very fast. Although I know this is going to sound really terrible, but in my day, everything went really slow. You wanted to get to school, you walked, or you took your bicycle. Where I initially lived, there wasn't even a school bus. I had to walk or take a bicycle. Didn't matter whether it was raining or snowing. That's how I got to school. It was slow. You wanted to go somewhere? You walked. You took your bicycle. Parents driving you somewhere? Whew, that was a big deal. Very rarely did that happen. After all, there was only one car, and my father took it to go to work. Drive me somewhere? Maybe somebody had a car. But now, cars zooming you here and there. In the cities, the subways are doing it. I didn't live in the city when I was young at that. I was born there, grew up there, but not that this time I'm talking. And everything was slower then, very slow. The telephone you dialed with a rotary, you didn't speed dial or just say some name and up comes the person. You had to rotary dial it. So you would dial it and then it would go brrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrr to back Actually, when I, up until I was about maybe 9 or 10, you had to dial the operator and tell her the number. And the number was a name with some numbers after it. I mean, to you younger people, that's inconceivable, but I would call up the operator and I would say, get me Murray Hill 853 or Pelham 775. Or, I mean, then they came up with direct dialing without operators. I mean, we thought that was like, my God, what's the world coming to? You could dial a number and get somebody. What I'm trying to say is the difference between then and now. Okay, technologically there's a huge difference, but the difference is speed. And I think this is incredibly significant. The speed of things. And I'm seeing just like the Earth is speeding up, the frequency is speeding up. There is a significant shift. Life is very fast, very crowded, stressed, and speeding up. The more people get together, the less they have to do with each other in the cities. You do not know your neighbors in your apartment buildings, in your flats. When I was young, okay, sorry, that sounds really terrible to say it. I mean, when I was young, like, my God, you know. But, you know, when I was young, you knew everybody in the neighborhood. Everybody was out there talking about everybody else. It's what you did, you know. This one's doing this, this one's doing that. Now you have no clue who you live with in the building. You may never even say hi to them. You may have no idea who you share life with. You sit on the subway or you sit in the bus or whatever. Millions of people, don't know any of them. And going faster and faster to do stuff. Rush out to go to work in the train, rush to the where you work, rush quickly to do things, rush back. Okay, you may not feel it like that, but if I am to think about the difference between then and now, the pace, the speed of things then, very, very slow. If you even look at movies from those days, of course you'd never do that because they're like watching dinosaurs walk around. You don't do that stuff. You watch modern movies. Modern movies, modern TV, very fast. Images shifting every, you watch these music video channels, every 2 seconds a new image. As if you could see the image for 10 seconds, you'd be bored to death and hate it and change the channel. 2 seconds. Different angles, different views, different. You look at a movie nowadays, it's always wild and weird and unsteady. Can't grab onto it. Okay, maybe some of them. But in the 50s, I mean, if you changed images the way they do today in the 50s, people would lose their minds. Not one person would watch it. I mean, the pace then, very slow. Just look at some of these old movies from the 50s, just for fun. And okay, you may not like the movie. Watch Casablanca, of course, maybe it's a little later, but. And then just get into the pace, even though that's a really paced run. I mean, just get into the mood. Get into the mood. Or listen to old radio shows. Get into the mood. Slower. And that which is significant comes less often. And changes and transformations come less often. And things are slower. And then think about modern life, which is so much faster. Anyway, just take my word for it. Now, what does it mean now? What does it mean to us? What does it mean as people? How does it affect us? How does it transform our lives? And why the stuff we're doing together actually counters this? These are important questions. And let's just consider for a second what we are doing together. We are countering the energy that is being pushed at us. We are countering the energy that is being pushed at us. We are countering the energy which is being forced upon us. We are literally declaring a revolution against the speed of what is going on in the world around us. There are other things too involved that we are trying to negate or trying to work with and trying to deal with, but one of the most significant things we are doing is we are transforming the frequency of our lives. And that's very important, to transform the frequency of life. We are transforming the frequency of our lives. We are taking the speed and not being affected by it. And we are declaring our own space with our own frequency. Now let's consider that for a second, because here's the key. We declare our own frequency. If we surrender to the space that is being provided for us, the frequency is dictated to us by the environment. The speed of things, the things themselves, the rate at which everything is moving spins us. Okay, maybe not physically turning around, but our energy is spinning. And for us to do something, we have to reach through that spin and incorporate whatever it is we want within that spin that is already there. Just like computer games take you and bring you into them. Virtual worlds, you're now absorbed in them. With your avatar, your virtual body, acting on your behalf within this already fixed context that is totally separated from you physically. And your consciousness is now flowing into that avatar so that your bodily fingers and the movements of that thing are one. Or when you absorb in the media that is blasting at you and negating your own frequency and programming your frequency. Or when you are interacting with others who have accepted such a programming and whose consciousness is projecting at you this accepted frequency. And unless you do something about that, your consciousness, your frequency, your existence is dictated to. And when you try to do something about it, you have to fight through it. And what does that create? Enormous stress. Because you're fighting through this atmosphere, this environment, which you find out when you start to fight, is pressing upon you, is restricting you, is making you something that's not you. So what are we doing here? You know, you're lucky. I'm old enough to have experienced those slow days. You're lucky I'm young enough not to be spoiled by war days like that. Okay, Vietnam, sure, but I mean to say, it's lucky because I can make this contrast. And I see that when we go into the meditative state, or when we embrace what we are, our being, we create our own space. And it's not even that we're creating it. It is our space, so we don't have to create it. It's our energy flowing out, establishing its own domain, declaring its integrity, and filling that space with our natural frequency, which when we combine with nature, which when we combine with spirituality, for example, with our deities or the deities in the temple, or we connect to God wherever we may be, that space becomes ours. And in that space, we feel the essence we are, and we may connect to the essence that is everywhere, to the divine, and we can free ourselves from the repressive stress that is pressing upon us. This is actual energetic survival. Now, last week we talked about survival in another way. But this week we're talking about survival in a much more intimate way. Much more, well, a fundamental way. That means we are speaking about the survival that we are as human spirit. That we are dealing with that fundamental problem that if our integrity, that integrity of frequency that we are, is taken from us, we essentially have nothing. Now, this concept is not new. All your great Russian authors from the days where they were repressed by the Tsar or otherwise, when they are in these faraway camps or they're imprisoned somehow, or in South Africa, we spoke about Nelson Mandela, they come to that conclusion that no one can take their spirit. No one can take the essence they are from them. Now that is beautiful. And even though it may not seem to be parallel at present, because after all, we're not in jail, we're not in camps, we're not repressed. So why should we worry about this? But in reality, we are pressed. We are in jail. Can you imagine telling a young person today, okay, now put your iPods, your iPhones, your computer games, your TVs, everything electronic, lock it up and go live in the country. What? Are you putting me in jail? Are you trying to kill me? So, yes, there is a lot of pressure, stress, restrictive elements in our lives. But they're subtle. They don't need to control people in the way they used to because they keep them bewildered by stuff, keep them bewildered by media, feed them what they should think, mold their values. You don't need to have forcible transformation. You don't need to repress people. You let them do what they want, but you create what they want and mold them into what will work. Nobody in any country of the Western world thinks about revolution because they got their stuff. And, okay, they vote out this one, vote in that one. Really no difference. It's all very carefully orchestrated. You can have this leader, that leader. They're all basically the same. Different flavors of the same. Vanilla with a little bit of honey. Vanilla with a little bit of, you know, molasses. Vanilla with a little bit of nuts. Vanilla with a little bit of cherries. You basically have one flavor and different little nuances because it's a safe flavor to keep us all very quiet. And indeed, we are quiet. And sometimes people make a rebellion and we go, gee, isn't that cool? Or, gee, isn't that interesting? Or, gee, we all know it's not going to make any difference. We've sold out. So what we do here is significant from all kinds of levels. And I feel the interdependent, interrelational way in which human beings relate within a community is very much dependent on that community being filled with individuals who have carved out their space, who have established their integrity energetically, who are living their own energy, living their own lives, who are not stressed, repressed, and dictated to by stuff, by things, by values, by frequencies, which are not natural to them. So if you want to have community, it must be amongst those who have integrity as individuals. The main problem with community is that it was previously based on the ideals, which were also a repressive ideal, a frequency, a value given to you that you fit within. And immediately there is a commonality between you and others because everyone is sharing something that is not them to make a commonality. Either a religious ideal or some ideological ideal or whatever. But modern community, no longer in the sense of modernity that I used before, which is a sociological term, but modern community, meaning at present, if it's going to work or future, must be based on individuals who are comfortable with their integrity and who hold on to it and maintain their frequencies. And when you meet others who do that, when you associate with others who do that, the community you build is relevant to you. It is going to be mutually beneficial and supportive because you accept that what you do has to be compatible with your frequency. The others do the same. When you interact, it is with that rule in mind that you don't want to distort or twist another's frequency. They don't want to do that to you. You accept them as they are. They accept you as you are. Okay, you can still make contracts, agreements. You can argue. But when you work together, it is not on the basis of a third party's intervention that is pressing you into a mold. It is on the basis of what you are, what the other person is, or what the group is. It's a relevant local unit, not something imposed from above, from afar. It is something based on a reality that is very relevant to the moment and the location and the circumstances of all the people who are standing near each other. Community, in that sense, is a total revolutionary concept. I mean, even though it seems obvious when I say it, but it's not obvious if you look at how things work. I mean, after all, I am painting pictures line after line, rationally building one thing after another, reaching back in the lecture, bringing it forward, saying, here, that's why this. But as obvious as it may seem, it is not being done. Or if it is being done, you don't know all that much about it. But in any case, this is what's required. Community based on essence, the essence and integrity of essence. But that has viable social principles, viable economic principles, viable political principles. Because you can't just come in with this ideal that everybody's going to be essence integrity and then everything will be fine. You need skills to make community. Skills on all different levels. But at least you'll get it together. At least it'll work. And those who commit to it, if it works, will have little reason to leave it. Whereas when you are pressed into a mold, as soon as you think about yourself in one way or another, you start feeling bad because why are you there? What are you doing? Better to leave it. So, I've talked about it a lot. You might be bored with this subject. I don't know. Well, maybe the time when you're forced to do something, you do it. But I like a lot of the relationships we have as people in our Harry Media community, because there's a lot of this going on, this integrity. If I was to insist you be something other than you are, you will get upset. I like that. That means something I've done has assisted you to figure it out for yourself. You're not going to just be what I say. You're going to be what you are. Great. And that's good. But to maintain that in connection with someone else you may not like, or that's where it's tested. I'm not saying you should like people you don't like. I'm not saying you have to do anything. I'm just talking about the subject. And I think what is valuable for us as people is to understand how this is a very spiritual principle. If you compare this to certain Varnashram principles, and we may have heard that Varnashram is a spiritual, quote-unquote, social system. Well, it's not bad. There's a lot of truth in that. If you think about what the Varnashram is implying, it's implying that you be what you are. Isn't that interesting? Don't try to be what you're not. Be what you are. And be what you are perfectly. Spiritually, it doesn't matter what you are. Your ultimate destinations, the way you have spiritual consciousness and so on, is not dependent on what you are. It's only dependent on you being what you are and from that spot moving on. So whatever of these various occupations you are, embrace it. Because the social interactions just make life more pleasant, make life more supported, fundamentally stabilize the society. And it's all based on being what you are, not being what someone else tells you you are that is not relevant to you. Isn't that cool? The original ideal is very much similar to what I've been talking about for years. The way it has become that if you're born into some family, then that's what you are, it's just ridiculous. That's totally unrelated to spirituality. But being what you are, and being it perfectly, and being peaceful with what you are, and active in what you are, and connected to the divine wherever you are, is a super principle. Okay, I definitely don't believe that some, you know, king had 10 million wives who were all barren. I mean, it's ridiculous. Okay, but somehow these social principles, they really got it. And they make sense. They really work. And they're very much dependent on the individual. It's a real society that's dependent on the individual, where the individual works as a cohesive part of a whole. But it requires a very strong management. Because if somebody starts exploiting somebody else, you lose everything. So it requires to make sure nobody's exploited. This is where all the troubles start. But if it's small enough, you can handle it. I mean, after all, why all these, for example, tribes who are not influenced by modern political manipulation that create wars and destruction, but these village formats, elders, teachers, farmers, families, generations taking care of children and bringing them forward. It's very strong. It's stayed for thousands and thousands of years because it has stability. And the only way it breaks down, besides all of these foreign influences of destruction, but is when somebody thinks they should speed it up to bring more happiness. You see it in India all the time. Okay, we don't like living in the village. We're going to go to the city to work. And they live in slums. Okay, in the village, they may not have had something too fancy, but they had their own house. They had something. They had peace. It was clean. You go to those slums, everything is like a hellish chaos. Did it get better? No. Okay, you may say, yeah, but when they come from Siberia and they move to Moscow, they can do so many wonderful things. Yeah, but then you have these energetic problems. Okay, you may get a flat somewhere and you may have, you know, you can have some questionable food and water, but, and especially questionable air, I'll tell you that. But then you have all these energetic problems of loss of integrity, of alienation. Alienation, that's the worst one, when we become alienated against each other. Alienated from each other, sorry. Where we lose contact and connection. It's a serious business. So, I thought I would share this essential principle of social integration that depends on the integrity of self within the context of the integrity of a group. And I'm not sitting here propagating Varnashram, I'm just speaking about its very useful elements. its fundamental truth and the way in which it does relate to spirituality. And I guess I'm waving the flag like this because I'm just waiting for the day when we do it, or people do it. And the idea that you'll only do it if I live there, that's like silly. I'm getting old. Not going to be around all that much longer. Besides that, you know, you can forget it. You think I'm going to move to some faraway place, learn another, yet another language, live yet another place. Traveling for me is difficult. It's your life, not mine. So then you say, it's too much trouble, forget it. Okay, maybe you like the way you live now. Okay, go for it. I'm not saying it's right or wrong. It is what it is. All I care is that you're safe, you're healthy, you're prosperous, and that you're energetic essence is creating the integrity of that space, maintaining the integrity of that space, establishing that space so that you can live in a peaceful, energetic environment that is not stressing you, pressing you, and bouncing you here and there. This is what I want. And I'm trying to assist that in whatever way I can, because it's what I do. All this technology that surrounds me is only a tool so I can sit here and do what I do. This technology is not what I do. I'd rather somebody else did it and I just came and sat and did. But amongst the people I know, nobody can do what I can do. Not that it's a bragging, it's a lament. It's a big time lament, you can't imagine. But of all the things I do, this is what I do. I like to be of service. So I like to, in this period of the week, carve out my space where there's this connection, where there's this connecting to you, connecting to that energy that needs to be expressed, to make the connections within us and between us that need to be there now more than ever before. And I like to be that instrument to make that happen to whatever degree I can. So I offer that to you in hopes that you offer to yourself all that you deserve, and that you offer to each other the structure within which you can connect and relieve the alienation, create spaces that are capable of security, capable of advancement, capable of prosperity, health, happiness, and capable of connection to that divine source. Those divine loving beings that are intimately concerned with what is taking place right now, are intimately suggesting, very carefully guiding, watching, assisting. So I wish you all love. I wish you all happiness. I wish you all peace.